You are listening to For a More Radio, your power station with powerful teachings from the Word of God.
Hello. Thank you for tuning in to What's Up on For a More Radio, where my guests share their life in Christ, their salvation testimony, life experiences, miracles, blessings, healings, deliverances, words of wisdom, and so much more. Thank you for tuning in, and let's get started. What's up, everybody? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory and welcome. Welcome to What's Up. Listen, y'all, I got something that has been on my heart for days now. And Overseer Jay Evans is my guest. He's my, you know, we're going to be doing a little bit of everything today. We're going to be interviewing each other kind of thing. I don't know. We're just going to let God have his way. But look, I'm for real, though. What's up, y'all? What's up? What's happening? And like I said, my guest today is Overseer Jay Evans. What's up, Overseer? What's
happening? Oh, man, it's great. It's a blessing to be in the presence of the Lord. Praise God and be saved.
Amen.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
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 Let's
thank you, Lord. Thank you, Abel, for being here with me. I feel so excited in my spirit because I believe that there's going to be breakthrough today. There's going to be healing and deliverance today. And I believe that the prophetic will flow, that God will open my eyes and allow me to see today, and that he will speak into my spirit, and I will say what I hear him say. This is the day that the Lord has made as a result, as an act of your will. That's what I'm trying to say. Rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. So today we're going to be talking about overcoming the fear of God disappointing you. I know that sounds a little odd, a little strange, and it's like, what in the world? What are you talking about? Listen, let me tell you something. If you have never felt disappointment before, having been praying for something and didn't get it, you might not get this message today. So let me ask you something. Have you ever believed God for something and it did not happen? It didn't change. You didn't get it. They didn't come back to you. It did not go away. Whatever it was you was praying for, it didn't stop. It didn't go up or come down. Whatever it was you was praying for, or you simply just did not get healed. You didn't get the money. You didn't get the position. You didn't get it. And now, secretly in your heart, you no longer trust that God will do anything for you. You're kind of just up in the air now. Now, I mean, you still pray and you hope that he'll answer you, but you still have so much uncertainty, hesitancy. There's even doubt. You are not even fully believing God for the little things that you pray for, because that disappointment really hurt you. It really bothered you. That disappointment has caused you to struggle. Now, how can you get over this? How can you get past this feeling? How can you get back to a place where you are excited and believing and trusting God? That's what we're going to be talking Amen. About today. Because let me tell you something. There is some restoration that needs to take place right now. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Listen, let me just play this breakthrough song right now, because somebody needs a breakthrough. And we're going to go ahead on and set the atmosphere with this breakthrough song. Listen to it. Let it minister to you. And then when we come back, we coming back with the word. Amen. So we coming back with a breakthrough word. You need to hear that. All right. So check out the breakthrough song, and then we will be right back.
In my life, I shall see what the Lord has in store for me. And I declare, I decree, my result is victory. In my life, I shall see what the Lord has in store for me. And I declare, and I decree, my result is victory.
The wait is over.
Lift your voice.
No more waiting.
The wait is over.
The wait is over.
Well, praise the Lord, we are back. So we're going to go ahead on and just kind of get started with the scriptures, right? Because Overseer and I walked through this yesterday and unpacked some of these things. And as we did, you know, I realized some things about myself. And I don't mind sharing about me. I don't mind sharing and letting people into my life a little bit, because one thing I'm fully persuaded of is that I'm saved. I'm saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. I'm fully persuaded that I have a relationship with God. I'm fully persuaded that I hear God and I can see when God shows me, you know, and I'm fully persuaded about those things. But I'm just like anybody else. Sometimes it's like, you know, you have those what the heck moments. God, what is going on? Or God, why you don't listen to me? Why you not hearing me? Why you not doing what I'm asking you to do? I mean, come on, y'all. If we just be honest and be real, we all have those moments. We don't understand what is going on. But sometimes there's a little something hidden on the inside of us that we need to bring up and deal with, because, you know, it's no different than a marriage. Your husband may say or do something, and that really bothered you. Your wife may have done something and said something, and it really bothered you. But then you talked about it, and you call yourself kind of getting over it, but it's still lingering there. It's still there. How do you know it's there? Because the next time something comes up, that thing, it arises. It arises. So let's go on to the Word of God. We're going to be coming from the book of James. We've been in James for a little while. But we're going to be coming from the book of James. And I'm just going to go ahead on and start reading from verse 1. Just, you know, just adding the context to this. Who is talking and what's going on. So we're going to be coming from James chapter 1, verse 1, starting with verse 1. But I'm going to be reading from the Amplified Bible. I wanted to read from the Amplified Classic, but they're close enough. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered abroad among the Gentiles in the dispersion, greetings. Rejoice. Consider it wholly joyful, my brethren, whenever you are enveloped in or encounter trials of any sort or fall into various temptations. Listen, be assured and understand that the trial and the proving of your faith brings out endurance, steadfastness, and patience. So what happens, Overseer, when you start going through something, when you start, something starts coming up in your life, something arise, your faith is being tried. Your faith is on trial. See, we would love it to be so easy to say, oh, I believe God. I trust God, you know, and you know, and then just go on, and because we said that, that make it so. Well, I don't think so. Yeah. You're gonna be tried for the words that you that for the word's sake, not the words you speak, but for the word's sake. Yeah. Okay, you're gonna be tried for that. What is that trial? It's just trying your faith. It's just showing you where you're really located at. We would love to say, "Oh, I'm saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost," and say those kind of things, and don't bit more live with God, live for God. But we're just saying it, and we would like for it to be true. Well, God has another plan. He said, "No." Now, that faith that you say you have in me, it's going to be tried. Because you need to know whether you really believe me. I know whether you believe me or not, but you need to know. Because when you find out that you really don't trust me, you really don't believe me, then now you got to go to a place where you need to work on that. And I'm going to show you how. But let's go on back to the scriptures. He said, be assured. Again, I'm reading James chapter 1, I'm on verse 2 now, but I'm reading in the Amplified. Verse 3 now, I'm sorry. He said, be assured and understand. Understand that the trial and the proving of your faith will bring out endurance and steadfastness and patience. If you put all three of those together, what this trial is doing is enabling you to stick and stay. With me no matter what. Mm. But see, what happened is when that trial come, sometimes you find out that you don't want to stick and stay with God. Because you're mad because he didn't do what you wanted him to do.
Say it.
I'm just saying, but let's go on. Verse 4 says, let endurance, steadfastness, and patience have full play, and do a thorough work so that you may be people perfectly and fully developed with no defects, lacking in nothing. So trials come to cause us to grow up, mm-hmm. causes us to be mature, causes our faith to be steadfast, causes our faith to be, our faith to endure, and causes us to be patient. What does that mean? The word patient means hopomone. It means to stay under the pressure while the pressure develops you. It means that word patience means let me do what I'm doing in you. Because what will happen is when hard situations come, you run. What will happen is when hard situations come, you become depressed. What happens is when hard situations come, you become angry. And now you don't want to. Let me throw a quick story in here. There was a young lady, and she was going through in her marriage. And she called on the elders. We prayed and prayed and prayed. Came over to her house and anointed his shoes and his clothes and all of that. When that man did not come back, I saw this with my own eyes in a vision. That girl's eyes blacked over. Her eyeballs completely went black.
My God.
And she left the church and did not come back. See, she wanted what she wanted. Mm. And when she didn't get it, the true state of how she was and who she was showed up.
Oh, my Lord.
See, God, you can't treat God like he just, he don't know anything and you can just do what you
like
want to do.
Genie.
Absolutely. Because he's going to show you the real you.
Yeah.
He's going to show you what you are really made of. He's going to show you if you really have faith in him or not. Why would he do that? Because you need to know. You don't need to be living this life having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. The power is in your faith in God. Mm. Because if you don't have any faith in God, you ain't walking with him. He said, it's faith that pleases me.
My God.
It's faith that pleases me. So you're not even pleasing him without faith. Let me go on back to the word. Overseer, did you have anything?
You own it. Thank God. Yeah, you own it.
Mm. Amen.
And then when you said, because of the word's sake, even the Bible lets us know when talking about the seed sown in different areas, that Satan come immediately for the word.
He comes for the word.
Yeah.
He comes for the word. So you can say anything you want. But your faith will be tried.
That's right.
It will be tried. And what should happen is maybe you, in the beginning, you stumble and fall a little bit and you see, okay, I really don't trust God. But then as situations come, you start realizing, okay, God gonna bring me out. He brought me out. Last time I was whining and complaining and crying, and I spent a whole month over something that disappointed me and made me feel bad. Well, I ain't going to do that no more because I know God going to show up for me. Let me go on with the word. He says, but let endurance, steadfastness, and passion have full play and do a thorough work so that you may be people perfectly and fully developed. Fully developed with no defects, lacking in nothing. Verse 5 says, if any of you is deficient in wisdom. Wisdom is having the knowledge and understanding, knowing what to do. Mm-hmm. Sometimes situations arise and you don't know what to do. Mm-hmm. You don't know what to do. You don't know how to respond. You don't know how to act. I'm going to go on with that and come back. And he says, let him ask. This is the Amplified. The giving God who gives to everyone liberally and ungrudgingly without reproaching or fault finding, and it will be given him. Listen, when you pray and you ask God, Lord, I don't know what to do. Help me to know what to do. God, give me wisdom. He said, no problem. It don't matter if you fail 15 times The fact that you're asking me for wisdom, I'm going to show up for you. Mm-hmm. I'm going to show up for you. But this is what he says in verse 6. He said, only it must be in faith that you ask me with no wavering. Now, this is where it gets sticky right here.
Oh, yeah.
This is where the rubber meets the road right here. He says, with no wavering, no hesitating, no doubting, for the one who wavers, hesitates, or doubts is like the billowing surge out at sea that is blown hither and thither and tossed by the wind. Let me give you a more of a visual. I want you to picture out in the ocean a little dinghy, a little small boat, right? And these huge waves are hitting out there in the ocean. They're rising and falling. I want you to picture that little boat just being tossed to and fro, going left, right, up, down, water getting in it, it coming back up, and just going all over the place. That would be a scary situation. Mm. That would be an uncertain situation. That would be a situation where you might feel like, I'm not going to make it. We're not going to make it through this. We're going to, you know, this boat going to go under. We're going to capsize. We're going to die, right? Because that boat all over the place. That's how your faith is. Mm. That's how your faith is. You're asking God, what should I do? God, give me wisdom. Show me what to do. But then you're all over the place. You're all, oh, I can feel the pain today. Oh, they sent me another letter saying they're going to evict me. Oh, they done called me. Oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, God. And you're all over the place being tossed to and fro, up and down, in and out. One moment you, oh, God, I know that you're going to work for me. I know that you're going to do that. The next moment, Lord, where are you? Did you forget about me? Oh, God, don't love me. You talking to other people and you're telling them, you know, I trusted God. I thought he was going to do it, but he didn't come through for me. And you thinking that kind of language is okay because of how you feel. The devil is a liar. You need to listen to what the Lord says. He said, for truly, now this is the hard part of this message. This is the hard part, but we're going to come with some good news. He said, for truly, let no such a person imagine that he will receive anything he asks for from the Lord. My God, God.
Yeah. Cut and dry, that's it.
My God, James done brought this thing home. He heard the Holy Ghost say this right here. You hesitating? You're doubting, you all over the place. You don't have no real faith. You doubt. You don't believe me. You don't believe me. You all over the place. He said, don't you expect to get anything from the Lord. Don't you imagine that you're going to get anything from the Lord. Because you don't even believe him. Yes. Let me show you something. Now, we say we're believing God for salvation. Overseer, let me ask you a direct question. Are you saved?
Yes.
If you died today, would you be with the Lord?
I believe it. That's
you right. Believe that wholeheartedly.
Right. And that's right. And live like that.
Could I shake you off of that? Oh, could no. I tell you, Overseer, you're not paying tithes.
Oh, no.
Overseer, you're not going to church. Overseer, you're not treating your wife right every day. Overseer, you're not giving to people. Overseer. Now, I'm using those things because those are the things that the church go after you about.
Mm-hmm.
You don't pay your tithes. You don't go to church. You don't give like you're supposed to. You ain't giving offerings and all of that. I'm asking those questions because those questions are unique to the kinds of things that the church will condemn you over. Mm-hmm. So, all right. So, I done asked you all those questions. I'm still asking you. Are you saved?
I'm saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. Yes.
That's it.
Yes, yes, that's it.
That's it. What if you messed up today?
Hey, I'm still saved. Confess my sins before him. He forgive me, and I'm keep moving.
What if you haven't? What if you still not on speaking terms with somebody?
Hey, I ask him to forgive me. I make it right. The Bible lets me know to reconcile with my brother, sister, And I do that and move forward.
So you telling me, here's the thing. Your soul salvation is based on the Lord Jesus Christ. But your response to what he's done in you is to do things that he say do.
What do you say? It's just that simple. That's right.
It's just that simple. See, that's how we are about salvation. Let somebody challenge us. Oh, no, I'm saved. I'm saved. You can't tell me I ain't saved. You can talk all that noise all you want to. I'm saved. Why? Because we trust God.
Yes.
We trust God to save us. We can't put that kind of faith in ourselves because we'll sin in a heartbeat.
Mm-hmm. That's
sin
right.
is not just you going to the club. It's not just you having sex outside of marriage. It's not you just cussing and carrying up. That's not, sin is you not operating in faith. God said it's if it's not a faith, it's sin.
Yeah, that's right.
You doing stuff. But it ain't even in faith. For those of you that are going to church and your salvation is based on you going to church, that is not profiting you anything. Mm. That actually is contrary to the word of God. Because we are the church. Wherever you are, that's where the church is.
That's right.
Where two or three come together in his name, he's in the midst.
That's right.
That's the church. You can have church with two people. Or you can go to a building with 50 people or 100. It don't matter. But it's all about the faith that you have in God. So he said, look here. Don't think you're going to get anything from God because you're doubting him. You're not trusting him. You're tossed to and fro. Mm-hmm. You don't know what to believe. You don't know what to think. You don't know if he's going to show up for you. Well, how do you expect to get anything? How do you expect to get anything? Listen, I found one thing, Overseer, that helps me with that. Because I'm not teaching or preaching or sharing anything that I didn't know. I'm sharing real life. But what helps me with that is when I read the scriptures, I will bless the Lord at all times and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. And I begin to meditate on that. And I begin to think about when bad stuff happened or uncomfortable stuff happened, you know, how could I get out of that? How could I come out from under that? Well, I could literally praise God.
Praise
God. Not praising God for what's happening, but praising God because I believe that no matter what, he's going to bring me out of it. And one way of demonstrating my faith is through my praise, my glorifying him, my exalting him. Now, I'm going to go to a real life story so y'all can understand how disappointment can get in your spirit. And it can affect your faith. And you may not even realize it. You might just be praying just because you know it's the right thing to do. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to go back to a place in my life. Overseer knows this story. I've shared this story before. But I'm going to share it again because somebody needs to hear this. Listen, when I was working out at the base, I had, for me, what I thought was the best job in the world because I loved what I was doing. I was super creative. I would write proposals and I remember writing a little essay thing and winning $10,000 at the job. The money wasn't for me. It went to the job. But, I mean, I was just doing things because I loved what I was doing. Mm-hmm. I had the energy and enthusiasm to just go to work and make stuff happen. But I also offended people.
Mm-hmm.
I also offended people because, you know, the way that I worked, it didn't require me to interact with a lot of people. But what it did is, it showed me looking like I was working my butt off, busting my butt every day to make that program successful. But there were other people where it looked like they wasn't doing anything. And I remember some of them saying to me, well, it don't take all of that. You don't have to do all that. I'm not doing all of that. You know, and that was things that they would say to me, not because I was asking them to do anything, because I preferred working by myself and I was good. But it made them angry. It made them feel some type of way like she's coming here showing off. I kid you not, guys. That's just how I worked. Overseer would tell you, no matter what I'm doing, I'm digging all the way in. I'm going in, right? So now People are getting upset with me. And one person came to that job, and that person was bold enough to go after me. And he and his mother did. They went after me. They wrote up stuff on me and turned it in like it was customers writing it. And, you know, it was just horrible. And then it went to the head people. And they were like, oh, my God. They were saying things like, well, she just make too much money. Because at this time, I had been elevated to the point where I was working full time, which that was not a position in that particular job. And I was traveling and had a government credit card. And I was just living a life. And I was enjoying myself. I was taking kids everywhere, you know, living it up and just having a good time. So all of a sudden, this major attack came, and the end result was they decided to move me. They were going to get even with me. That it was nothing but the enemy. But God allowed it. God allowed it. So they were going to get even with me. They took me from working with teenagers where I loved, and that's why I shine, and they put me into working with babies. Now, keep in mind, this whole time I'm praying. I done got this, you know, they told me about 2 weeks in advance that I'm going to be moved. And so now I'm praying and I'm believing God. And, you know, I'm just believing God and believing God. Well, that day came.
It came.
It was May 24th. That day came. And listen to me, y'all. They moved me. My faith crashed and burned on that day. I didn't know what to do. Now, just that day, I was so heartbroken and so disappointed. And, you know, I was down and I just didn't know what to do because I did not enjoy working with little children. Mm-hmm. I mean, I had two little kids of my own. And they were, my word to them was, all right, hurry up. Let's go through. Let's get through this level right here. Come on. Let's get off the bottle. Let's get off the breast. Let's get out of Pampers and diapers. Let's get in panties. Let's get in. You know, I was like, let's grow up. Let's grow up. I didn't enjoy those years. I enjoyed the years where they would talk and laugh and, you know, make jokes and cut up. I enjoyed those years. So here I am now. I'm put in a place where I'm miserable. Mm-hmm. I'm miserable. My husband is telling me, look, you don't have to stay there. You can leave. I can take care of you. I can afford to take care of you. But I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to be that person. And so I know this story seems long, but just follow along with me. So then, you know, every day I would sit outside and I would pray. I did that anyway, but now I'm praying for courage to go in and to work and to do this. Praying to have life and energy inside of me because I'm miserable and I'm, you know, and I just don't understand. I'm still praying to God, but I feel like he let me down. I just felt like he let me down. But I'm going there. But as I'm going there, there was these little bright lights flickering. Like the boss pulled me into her office and pulled all the leadership and said, I'm not going to let this woman fail. I saw her, what do you call that?
Resume?
Resume. That shows how she works. This lady got excellent across the board every single year. She's not going to come over here and fail. That's not going to happen. That was a meeting. They called me in. And so they started coming up with things that I could do because they knew I wasn't gifted with little children. Let me tell you something. You can be in a place and pray. But if that's not where you fully anointed to work, it's going to be a struggle.
That's right. Right? Yeah.
God will give you grace to get through it, but it's still going to be a little bit of a struggle because your heart ain't in it. My heart was not in working with little kids. But that leadership, they worked to find things for me to do to get me out of the room with little kids because that just was not where my anointing was. So finally, you know, other little things started happening. I was able to come into work at 5:00 in the morning. That was a blessing for me. Mm-hmm. I love coming in at 5:00 in the morning, getting up really early, driving to work and having that peaceful time. That was another little flicker of light. Little things happening to help me make it, right? But then this happened. Now, keep in mind, I'm still praying. I'm still believing God, but I'm still there at that job.
That's right.
And I'm not happy. I'm not really happy overall. Here, the boss invites me to go to Woman Thou Art Loose with her. That was really weird because I worked for her. But me and a few other people, we all flew out there to Texas. It was great. I had a good time. But I was in one of T.D. Jakes. He was preaching and he was talking about the pecking order or something. I don't know what it was. But he said something and it says, if I heard God say to me, okay, now you can get ready to leave the job. I want you to put your resume in, put your... not your resume in, but your final thing that you're going to leave the job. And I felt so confident in that. And I got in the vehicle and I said, I'm putting in my unofficial resignation to leave the job. And they were like, what? I said, yeah. I said, I'm going to be leaving. 2 weeks later, September the 13th, I think it was, I left that job. I said, keep in mind, now the whole time I was miserable, I didn't know what God was doing. Matter of fact, I'm thinking that I'm going to be stuck in this job, right? But that day, I put my resignation in, right? 2 weeks later, I was off the job. From that day forward, everything changed, everything. I was already working my business, but it blew up. I became the sole owner of my business, right? Then, because I was working my business, but I was working through somebody else's company. But when I stepped out on faith, I literally stepped out on faith. So I started, my business came to life. I got the contract in my own name, under my own Sam's registration and everything. Then I started getting, meeting people. And I mean, just so many things happened. So I won't go through all those details. I'm going to bring this to a close. What happened is, God had kept me on that job for 1 year. And for 1 year, what he was doing was pulling me up out of that job. I was so rooted into that job that that's all I knew. I couldn't do anything else. I couldn't see anything else. Nothing. I didn't see being no business person. I was into that 9 to 5. But for 1 year, he had me out there with them little children. And it was such a struggle that when he said, put in your resignation, it was none but a thing. I did it. He had started uprooting me out of that job. It was my desire to retire from that job at a certain age. And I completely forgot about that because I thought, well, I'm leaving the job, so I'm not going to be able to retire from the job. The Lord said, not so, honey bunny. 5 years after I had left, they called me out there to talk to me about something. And they said, well, you can retire if you want to. I was like, shut up. They said, yes, ma'am, you can retire if you want to. I retired from that job. So I'm actually officially a retiree. I've been retired for a few years now. And so all of this stuff happened after what looked like the worst time in my life. I was humiliated, embarrassed, hurt, disappointed, but the whole time, ooh, God was preparing me to be the boss. Amen. Not to work for somebody, but to be the boss, to have my own company, to set my own rules. So here I was going to work 8 to 5 or 11 to 8, and I had to work them hours 5 days a week. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I could only get vacation when it was approved. Y'all, come on now. Listen, he made me my own boss. He said, you don't work no 8 hours a day unless you want to, right? You don't have to work here and there and show up and this and that. You can hire people to work for you. You don't even have to show up. You can hire. I mean, life completely changed. But let me go to the money part. Now, I was making good money out there. Mm-hmm. Making good money. And I had just a little bit of money in savings. You know what I'm saying? God said I can do exceeding abundantly above all that you could ask or think. I'm going to pull you off that job and I'm going to give you more money than you ever thought you could have. Look, and that right there hadn't even fully stopped yet. He's still doing that.
Amen.
He's still doing that. Why am I telling you this long story? I'm telling you this story to say I know what it feels like to feel disappointed and to feel like God didn't show up for you. And then later, that thing affected me. It was still in my spirit because when it started coming down to praying for other things that I considered to be big things or large things or hard things, I struggled. I struggled because I remember that God had, to me, God had let that situation crash and burn. Woo-hoo. I was humiliated. People was writing things on me, and I didn't get to fight my battle. I didn't get to do all of that. So when I had to pray for something else, there was a little bit of uncertainty there, overseer. Mm-hmm. There was a little bit of hesitancy there. There was a little bit of doubt there. After God done showed me all of this, it don't matter that you say. He said, let not that man imagine that he will receive anything that he asks from the Lord. That's what James said.
Yeah.
So here I am, done went through that. I'm on the positive side of it, being blessed, living the life, you know, and all of that. But then when it came down to praying for something else, that little thing would creep back up, mm-hmm. that God may not do it. See, that was it right there.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
You may pray about it, but God may not do it. Remember now, you remember what you went through. He may not do it. No. That's the wrong way of looking at that.
Your faith.
The right way of looking at that is that, God, you got this.
Yeah.
You got this. I may not understand why you said no. I may not understand why you didn't let it go through. I may not understand you still have me here. I may not understand how my marriage crashed and burned. I may not understand. Y'all, look, I ain't telling you nothing that I don't know. I ain't telling you nothing. I'm a born-again believer. Here I am facing a divorce again. The first divorce, I didn't have a problem with it because I wasn't saved. He wasn't saved. We had just come together and so on and so forth, right? That thing crashed and burned. But here I am, saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, on fire for God, and now I'm facing a divorce. Yeah. Once again, I'm ashamed, embarrassed. I feel so bad. And then for the people that are saved and they've been married for years, you know, I felt like there was no comparison because I always gonna have that stain on my life. The devil is a liar. He's a liar and the father thereof. Because let me tell you something. Let me tell you something. That marriage crashed and burned. And I felt like that was it for me.
Mm-hmm.
I felt like, you know, I need to do what the word says. I'm divorced and I don't need to get married. See, when you don't understand the scriptures, you will condemn yourself. You will put yourself in prison because, you know, you don't really understand what it is the Lord is saying. I ain't going to get into the depths of that. If you need to talk to me about that, we can talk. But let me tell you something. 7 years after I was divorced, not after I divorced him, but after I was divorced, 7 years after that, I'm going to call that my time of completion, my time of getting what was in my spirit out. God sent me a word that he was preparing me for a man. I didn't even want no man. I didn't want no man. I ain't want no relationship for 7 years. I've been without no man. I haven't dated. I haven't had no nothing.
Amen.
And I was enjoying myself. I don't want no man. That's too much work. I know what it's like to be married. You got to cook and clean and do all of that. I didn't want no man. But God let me know he was preparing me for a man. And true to his word, the unction I had in me, he prepared me, and sure enough, overseer J. Evans showed up. God used Eleazar, a.k.a. Craig Shannon, to bring this man into my life. And this man sought God, prayed, sought God. 6 months later, after that, we were married. We have been married now 13 years. We're going on 14 years of knowing each other. And it's as if it's like day one. We have been a hand and a glove in this relationship together. That does not mean we have not had any difficult times because we still have flesh. But we choose to live in the spirit, which means that you're going to have less altercations in the flesh.
That's right.
You're going to have less situations in the flesh when you try to stay in the spirit. And that's what we do. We prepare ourselves daily to be in the spirit. So when I'm telling y'all this stuff, I know what I'm talking about. I know what it feels yes. like to be disappointed and to be embarrassed and humiliated and going through something in front of everybody. And then now you're supposed to just walk away and just believe God like everything's okay. But you got to come on out of that and look at what happened after that. Look at what was the end result. See, you still in the moment. You still in the moment of feeling embarrassed and ashamed that you didn't get it and that everybody saw it and that you was telling everybody that you was going to get it and it was going to be yours. See, you still there.
Hallelujah.
You need to come out of that place. And you need to walk forward and turn around and look back and say, God, I thank you. I thank you that you didn't allow me to stay in that. I thank you that you did not give me that. I thank you, Lord, that you set me free from what could have been a serious bondage in my life, that where I would have been controlled by somebody else. If I had went in that direction and stayed there. See, you got to look back at what did God save you from? What did he keep you from? What did he preserve you from? You got to go back and now you got to turn around and say, okay, God, you didn't do that. You didn't give me that. But what do you have for me? What do you have for me? Because when he was keeping you, all he wanted you to do but just trust me. I got you. Just trust me. Even now, God is telling you. He said, yeah, you feel bad. Yeah, you feel like, God, I let you down because you can't see your way and you don't understand what's happening. He said, but just trust me because by the time I get done with this and you look back at it, you're going to be praising like mad. Because you're going to be like, oh, God, had I did that? Had I went there? Can I just give one more?
Yeah, yeah.
So in business, I had set up some things to do for my sites. And I got ready to go do them, and Overseer and I was dressed. We had all of our gear and everything.
All the equipment.
All the equipment, and we going over here to do some training, and we got there to do some training. And it was like the leadership had quit.
The director had quit.
The other person didn't know what was going on. It was just a mess. And I'm like, God, what just happened? We left, and I was just, I don't know, I just felt like, man, that was just kind of messed up. Let me tell y'all something. While that happened, on the other end, another person was being put in charge over all of my sites. Another person. And the other person
we had favor with.
Had favor with, set it up so I could come in and train everybody.
Everybody.
At one time.
Oh, yeah.
At one time, not two or three here, or, you know, this site may have seven people, this site may have 12, or no, brought them all in. Every last one of them brought them all in and brought me in to train them all at one time. All I could do was just say, okay, God, what is that teaching me? That's teaching me that when things don't go the way that you think they should go and you feel bad about it, you got to get back to that place of trusting God. He said, trust him with all your heart and lean not into your own understanding. Stop trying to figure out why you didn't get it. Stop trying to figure out why it didn't last. Stop trying to figure out why this happened that way and this way. Stop. Get back to the place of trusting God so he can manifest to you what he was doing. Because if he try to show you what he was doing, you're going to miss it. You're going to skip right over it. Why? Because you're still looking at that situation. Yes. You're still pining away about what happened and how could they do this. And this person did that and they said this. And then it cost me this and it cost me that. You know what? When it come down to money, you may have sold that money, and that money may not have been good ground. You may have lost it, and you may feel bad about it. Maybe you didn't really seek God. You just had a good feeling, and you liked them, and you thought this was a good place to do that and everything. Maybe you did lose that money.
That's the wrong attitude.
Let me tell you something. I can tell y'all story, crazy stories. Overseer, you probably got some of these.
Oh, yeah.
Look, I've sown some money into what I believe was God, and that money was lost. It was just lost. And I had to walk away. I'm not one of those people said, oh, the devil done did this, and the devil done did that, and the devil did. Yeah. I don't believe like that. I believe God uses the devil to accomplish his will sometimes.
That's right.
It's scriptural what I'm saying, because Paul said that this man was going to be turned over to Satan for his soul to be saved, mm-hmm. right? That we also see where in Job, how that God allowed the enemy to really just, what appeared to be literally destroy Job's life. But in the end, God gave him back more than he had and blessed him thoroughly, right? We also see where the enemy do stuff. He killed Christ, even though that happened, if it had not happened, we wouldn't have what we have today. So God will use the enemy. So stop saying, oh, the devil done did this and the devil done did that. No, change your mindset. God, what are you doing? What are you doing? See, this is me. I'm going to tell you how I get through this stuff. I said, God, I don't want to walk around feeling sad. I don't want to walk around feeling depressed. I don't want to walk around feeling bad with no energy and depressed and that. I don't want to feel like that. So I'm going to go head on and praise you, and I'm going to do it by faith. Amen. Because I want to feel good. I don't want to be that person that's walking around, and then every time you see somebody, you rehearsing this story, what done happened to you and how people did. No, stop. Get off of
that. That's it.
Get off of that and begin to praise God. You're not praising him for the bad that happened. You're praising him for, God, there's some wisdom in this. Something is going on. You blessing me some kind of way. Maybe even you teaching me how to trust you in a hard time. You teaching me how to trust you and have faith when I can't see you. When I don't know what's happening. So instead of me being depressed and now I can't pray and I don't know what to do, you know, I got to trust you. It's those times when you call the people that you know that can pray. Don't call them folks that's going to sit there on the phone and listen to you. Wah, wah, wah. You just playing the violin and going on and on and on. No, don't call them. Call the ones that you know is like, hey, sis, I understand that's what you went through, but let's pray. Brother, I hear you, but let's pray. Mm-hmm. That's the people that you want to call when you're going through.
That's right.
Don't call your best friend who's going to be like, what they did? What?
Yeah.
I can't believe they did that. Do not call that person, because that's not the time for them. Call the one that don't want to hear all the details. Let's just pray and listen to God in the prayer. Mm-hmm. Let him speak. My God. Overseer.
When Apostle Paul, when he went through, mm-hmm. and he said, you know, I prayed three times. I've been praying three times, and nothing happened. Mm. Nothing happened. You know, so he didn't go out there and complain to his other evangelistic crew, Titus and Timothy. He didn't say that. Mm. He said, I talked with the Lord, and God spoke to me and let me know. You know, my grace is sufficient. Whatever you're going through, yes, grace increase. So whatever we're going through, God gives us a greater grace to go through it. The fact of the matter is, if you're going through and you're not trusting God, then how are you going to allow the grace of God to come up to give you the power to overcome that?
Mm, 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 mm.
Because whatever you're going through, God's going to give you the grace to go through it. So trust God that God, you know what? Grace is sufficient. Mm. I'm going, God, your grace, your gift. I see the other side of it.
Mm. You got to get past that feeling, though. See, that's the problem right now. You still in the feeling. You got to get out of that feeling. Feelings come and they go. You're actually generating that feeling on the inside of you because you want to sit there and stew a little bit and feel bad a little bit because you didn't get what you wanted, because things didn't go the way that you wanted. You thought that you had more wisdom and insight and knowledge and understanding than God did. You thought, oh yeah, this right here is good for me because, you know, it's going to do this for me. Or he's great. You know, I can see me and him going to be together in ministry. And, you know, you thinking all this stuff because you think you know more than what God know. But you don't. So you got to get out of that feeling. I'm going to go to the scriptures the overseer just said. Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, he said, for this thing, whatever it was that happened, that was going on in his life, where Satan was buffeting him, he said, for this thing I besought the Lord, I'm doing King James, sought the Lord three times, that it might depart from me. And he, being God, said unto me, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace is all you need. My grace is enough. My favor, my unmerited favor, my blessing is enough for you. My strength is made perfect in your weakness. So right now, you give way to me. You allow me, my grace. You allow my favor to rise up in you, even in the midst of this situation, this thing. Because for some people, it's not that God didn't take it. I mean, for some people, it's because it's still there. You may have been believing and praying and asking God to heal you. And, you know, you just can't receive this sentence, this diagnosis. You can't receive it. And, you know, I can't live my life like this. God heal me. And you thinking that you believe in God, but you desperate because you don't want it. But God didn't take it away. And he said, in your weakness, my strength is made perfect. I'm going to make you strong even in the midst of this.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to use you. My glory will be upon you even in the midst of this. When you give that testimony, there will be people that are beaten down, broke down, messed up from the same thing. But they're going to see you and they're going to hear your testimony. And they're going to be like, my God, hallelujah. Why did I leave God? If this is what I could have, God, help me. If this is how my life could be, God help me. But Paul say, and then the rest of that scripture says, most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, for this reason, because God's strength is made perfect in my weakness and his grace is sufficient, for this reason, I take pleasure
with praise
in
and honor.
Infirmities and reproaches and in necessities, in persecution, in distress, for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then am I strong.
Oh, whoa, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So let me tell you, listeners, we got 2 minutes. I'm going to tell you, you are not weak. You are strong. You are not beaten down, but you are an overcomer. You are not stressed out. You are blessed. That's what you are. Not stressed, but blessed. Woo-hoo. Only thing you got to do right now is you got to change your mind. You got to go and do what Philippians 4? Yeah, Philippians 4. You got to go and do what Philippians 4 said. You got to think on things that are true. You got to think on things that are lovely. You got to think on things that are of a good report. You got to think on the good things. You got to remember what God brought you from. Let me go to that scripture. Philippians 4:8. It says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. You thinking about what you done lost? That's not a good report. You thinking about what happened and it didn't go your way? That's not a good report. You got to think on the blessings of the Lord. This is what the Lord told me, overseer. With everything that's going on in America and around the world, you know, I'll use one in particular, and this is just because we saw this yesterday. That black woman over there in Russia that's in prison. We know what happened in North Korea to that young man. They beat that man mercifully and then let him go, and eventually he died, right? That stuck with me, and I was thinking about, oh my God, Lord, please don't let them let this girl go. I didn't even know there was another man over there until they said it. But, you know, but the Lord had told me earlier, before, you know, I saw that, he says, keep your mind on my goodness. Mm. See, If we don't keep our mind on God's goodness, we will be pulled into this anxiety. We will be pulled into this worry, fear. All of that is anxiety. We'll be pulled into that. And next thing you know, you worried. Oh, monkeypox out. Oh, COVID is coming back up. And now you worried about all of this. But yet, God done kept you this whole time.
Oh, my Lord, yeah.
He done kept you this whole time. Yes. See, pull back. And look back at your life and look at how God has kept
you, Jesus.
Brought you through. And stop making all of these negative comments. Stop looking at that little situation, which was nothing but a dime in the middle of $1 million. It's just a dime, right? Mm-hmm. Stop looking at that as if that's the $1 million. Because it's not. That was just one dime. One dime. What am I saying? I'm saying this thing that you rehearsing over and over in your mind and in your spirit, this thing you keep going on and on and on about, this is just a small thing. It's just a little thing in life. You got so much more life, so much more, so much, many more blessings coming your way. You don't want God to give you stuff that will cause you to end up in some type of bondage and it end up not being the best or the blessings that he wants for you. You want him to shut it down. You want him to end relationships that's going to cause the enemy to have free reign to go after the word in you. There are people right now that wanted a spouse so bad that they married the first thing came, first thing that fell off a truck, and now in their own house they can't pray because the enemy inside of that man or that woman gets irritated, gets aggravated. They can't play Christian music in the house. They wanted a man or woman that bad. And now they wish they would have never, ever married them. But see, now you're in it. You're in it. And God is going to use whatever the enemy is doing. He's going to use it to be a blessing for you. He's going to make you strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So he's going to work it out for you. He's not going to just leave you there. And it's like, oh, well, you did this. You well, Opie say, You made your bed, now sleep in it.
Yeah.
Opie Taylor.
That's what mama always say. You make your bed hard, you got to sleep in it.
Mm-hmm. Amen. So we're going to get ready to get up out of here, guys. I do hope that this word has strengthened you and encouraged you. See, encouragement is not always, oh, you're so wonderful and so sweet and I just love you and you're so amazing. Encouragement is letting you know, put your boots back on. Pull your pants up, put your jacket on, put your hat on, and get on back out there and get to work. Get to work. Do what you're supposed to be doing. And you work where God have you planted. Give it 100%. Wherever God have you, that's where you do what you do. Whatever you lost, it wasn't for you. Because there's greater. I'm telling you, if you know God, if you've been walking with God, you know God, you know something else, something better is coming. Yes. So be on the lookout. Be in anticipation. And more than anything, have faith in God. If you don't do nothing else the rest of the day, you say, self, have faith in God.
Self-talk.
Have faith in God. No matter what happens, have faith in God. Every time I do something, I have to go to this place right here.
Yeah.
Have faith in God.
Yeah.
Because the temptation to be worried, fearful, fretful, all that, it's always there. Mm-hmm. But have faith in God. So I hope we've answered how you get over this or how you get past these feelings. You go back to a place of looking at your life and say, my God, you have been good to me.
That's right.
You have been good to me.
God is faithful.
You have brought me through so many trials and situations and circumstances. You have brought me through. You're going to bring me through this. So I'm going to go head on and rejoice in the Lord today. I'm going to go head on and rejoice in the Lord as a way of life. Because you're always going to do good for my life. Always. It's always in that scripture, overseer. All things work together for the good to them that
love God.
And
was called according to this purpose.
That's right.
And he called it his purpose.
Those that are called according to his purpose.
His purpose. So our trials and tribulation isn't in line with God's purpose.
Amen. For us. Amen. Amen.
But you know, I will say this. you're a good example of what, you know, you have a lot of things going on in your business, your paperwork and things and requirements. When budgets come around, you had to redo this, do that. And it gets to the point where, like, I don't know what to do. I don't know. And you begin to pray, and then it works out. And then things happen, and they're like, oh, that's not going to work. But then all of a sudden, it comes to pass. Mm-hmm. God is in the midst. And like that, say, we went to that place, and that they trained those employees. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm like, okay. It's like, okay, well, God got something else. And there it is. It show up. Mm-hmm, I think when you get to the point where you accept what God is doing.
Yes.
When you accept what God is doing, if you in God, you accept what God is doing. And it's not saying the enemy is doing it. You accept God is working things out. Then that's when God can work things out for you and bring things to pass. Mm-hmm. But if you still stay in there, and your mindset is there that's. The enemy is doing that. The enemy is doing that. Your focus is on the enemy, not God.
That's right. That's right. You're actually exalting the enemy. That's why I feel the way that I do. I know that the enemy has power, but the power that he has is limited. He only has what God allowed him to do. That's it.
That's right.
Because if he had power, like some people think he had power, he could destroy this earth just like that. Oof. He could shut God down.
That's something.
He doesn't have power like that. He is a tool in God's hand. So anything that's happening, God is allowing this or not allowing it, whatever the case may be.
He's a creative being.
Yeah, and so you have to, your faith and your trust has to be in God. Yeah, but what happens when you don't get what you want and you feel so bad? That's how I felt. I felt like, God, they just came and just took my job. Now, when I was saying that, I was talking about the people, because they did. They was like, oh, we moving her. And let me, I didn't even tell y'all the rest of the story. The person that did the actual moving ended up getting fired.
Yeah, see?
End up getting fired and completely lost the job. And then I had people fighting for me. They were going up there, mad. They were mad. One person in particular, I praise God for that woman right now, went and fought on my behalf. Keon, that's her name. Keon, she went and fought on my behalf. She didn't even know me like that. But she was fighting on my behalf and blessed me thoroughly. And so, but I know what it feels like to feel like, you know, you don't have no control and you're losing. But it's like now you could. Overseer, when we would drive out there on post, I believe you asked me one time, did I miss it? I was like, oh, no.
You know,
I
would say this right here. God used Pharaoh and God used all those kings to discipline Israel, to get Israel to a point. And then once he used them, he judged them. Now God used those people to get you to where you need. And then now God judged them. And bring things, and one lady put lost her mind, the head leader.
That was the same one.
Yeah,
it was the same one. So, but see, when you look back at it, and all the pain and the felt and the disappointment, all that you felt, you know, it's like, man, because I really didn't trust God. I just did not trust him the way that I should have. Somebody just sent a message, said, regardless of the situation, you know, you still got to trust God. Absolutely.
Amen.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So listen, we love you guys. We thank you that for tuning in and listening to this broadcast today. We wanted it to be live on Four More Radio at 12 p.m., but the mics were out. So, you know, you can't do a broadcast without mics. So what I'm going to do is, for those of you that's listening, you will be able to... Okay.
Inez.
Praise God. Let me see. What did Inez say? Inez, thank you for coming on. Praise God. Thank you for amen. Yes, Lord. Praise God. I see everything that you're saying, Inez, and we thank you so much for your comments. Thank you for popping in, because this was one of those we didn't have this one prepared for, you know, to go out. But for those of you that are listening, we appreciate you. Always know that, you know, you can follow, you can catch any of our broadcasts on any of the major other platforms. One of my favorites is Audible. I love Audible, but and you can find me on Audible. I love that. Also, guys, you know I'm here with Overseer Jay Evans. Don't forget, on Wednesdays at 7 p.m., you can at 6 p.m., you can catch him, Eastern Standard Time, you can catch him with the word with Overseer Jay Evans. And I'm telling you, you do not want to miss that. If you're one of those people that just want to learn the Bible and learn what it means to your life and, you know, what it means for his prophecy goal and what the book of Revelation and Daniel and all of those things that, you know, are a little bit perplexing, this is the broadcast you want to listen to. God has blessed me to be able to sit under him and learn and listen. Even though my style is a little bit different, I sit up under this man and I learn constantly. And so you want to check him out as well. You'll find him on Spreaker and you'll find him on Live 365 for More Radio at the same time. If you just like to, you know, listen to music and then you want to catch that broadcast. So yeah, but we're going to get ready to get up out of here. Right, Thank you so much for coming on WhatsApp. Even though it looks like we're doing The Good Life with Dr. Lori, I'm telling y'all, it's both. What's Up is me, and The Good Life with Dr. Lori is me, and we always have Overseer Jay Evans as a, you know, to come and be our partner here on both of the programs, and we appreciate that so much. Listen, get your trust back, get your faith back, and go believe God for big things, great things, greater things, and just put your faith in him and what he will do. Don't put your faith in you and what you want and how you want it. Don't do that. Just put your faith in him. Give him something to work with and then let him do it the way he's going to do it. All right?
Amen.
So God bless you. We're not going to get up out of here with no song because after this goes off on Live 365 for More Radio, music will be playing. So be blessed. God bless you and have a great rest of the day. Hallelujah.